So in this video, we're going to talk about oscillations. And oscillations are extremely fundamental to physics. The oscillations of the fundamental fields that exist in the universe is what creates particles, and it's the particles that make up us, the stars, the planets, and everything else. At the other end of the scale, we have an oscillation that can be described as the sun orbiting the center of the galaxy, and that oscillation takes about 200 million years to complete. Now, obviously, those types of oscillations are going to be quite complicated to explain, so here we're going to focus on mechanical oscillators. So that's a mechanical system obeying Newton's laws of motion that oscillates back and forth. And those types of oscillators have certain key features. For a start, they've got to have an equilibrium position. That's a position where the net force on whatever's oscillating backwards and forwards has to be zero, so that if you put it there and leave it, it would remain in that position. Then, when you disturb it from that position, you have to have a force that acts to move the object back to that equilibrium position. And how that force changes with distance from the equilibrium position will govern exactly how the oscillator behaves. And so that's easy to demonstrate with this magnetic track. So this is a metal track that's filled with magnets. And what we're going to do is we're going to put onto it a superconductor that excludes the magnetic field. So essentially it floats on top of the magnets. And then the force will come from the curve of the magnetic track. And that's something that's easy to change. So let's see this system in operation. So here we have the system oscillating backwards and forwards, and I'll set it oscillating again, and then I will change the shape of the track. And you can see that as I do that, the frequency of the oscillation increased. So let's do that again. Here's the slower frequency. Here's the higher frequency. It's vibrating backwards and forwards a lot more rapidly now than it was before. So clearly, there are going to be different ways to characterize oscillators. So let's look at a very simple oscillator, and we'll have a look at how to characterize the motion. So here we have one of the simplest systems in physics that oscillates. It's the mass on the end of a spring. Now, if I have the mass here, it's sitting in its equilibrium position. The force acting upwards on the spring, which is governed by Hooke's law, is exactly countered by the force of gravity that acts downwards. But if I move the mass up a little bit, I've reduced the extension of the spring, and that reduces the upwards force, because that's what Hooke's law tells us. But gravity remains constant, and so now I have a net downwards force. So if I move the mass up a little bit, it returns to the equilibrium position. Similarly, if I move the mass down from the equilibrium position, I increase the extension of the spring, which through Hooke's law tells me that I'm increasing the upwards force, and gravity, of course, remains constant, so I have a net upwards force that will return the mass to the equilibrium position. So that's all the ingredients we need to have a system which oscillates. So, to show it oscillating, let's pull it down and let it go. So you can see that the system is oscillating. Now, to compare this oscillator to other oscillators, we need to define a system of physical quantities that we can use to describe this motion. So the first thing to think about is, supposing I put my hand here to measure a point, and we can ask ourselves, how long does it take for this mass to go through one complete cycle of its motion? So here my hand is close to the top of the cycle. So what we're asking is, how long does it take the mass to start here, go down, and come back up to the same level? And that time is what we call the period of the oscillation, and in SI units, the period of time is measured in seconds. Now, as well as the period of an oscillation, for some oscillators, particularly those that have very, very short periods, a more useful quantity to measure how long it takes for the oscillator to complete a single cycle of its motion is what we call frequency. And frequency is defined as the number of cycles that an oscillator will complete in 1 second. And so the units for frequency are seconds to the minus one, and in the SI system, we call that unit the hertz. And the relationship between frequency and period, since frequency is the number of cycles per second, the frequency is just equal to one divided by the period, so the reciprocal of the period. Now, that's how we describe how long it takes for an oscillator to complete its motion. However, we also have another quantity, and I'll demonstrate this here. So initially, I'm going to start this mass oscillating, and you can see that it's going up and down and not moving very far. Whereas if I do this, it's now moving a lot more. So clearly, those two oscillations, we want a way to compare and contrast those. And to do that, we have to introduce a new quantity called the amplitude. Now, for a mechanical system like this, the amplitude is the maximum displacement of the mass from the equilibrium position. So for this system, it's measured, it's a distance, and we measure it in meters. However, that's not the case even for all mechanical oscillators. If you think of a simple pendulum, there we have a system that swings backwards and forwards, and so the maximum displacement there will be an angle, and we measure it in radians or degrees. Another example is if we go outside mechanical oscillators and we go to an electromagnetic wave, there you have an electric or a magnetic field that's oscillating, and so there the amplitude will be given in units of the magnetic field strength or the electric field strength. So the amplitude, the units for the amplitude depend on the system that is oscillating. So we've talked about how to characterize the motion of an oscillator, and what we want to do now is show that those characteristics of motion depend on the physical parameters of the system. So here we have three springs. Each of these springs has a different spring constant, and I'm going to put different masses on them, and you can see the effects on the period of the oscillation. So first I'm going to take the red spring, and I'm putting a small mass on the end of this. So you can see the equilibrium position, the spring is extended slightly, and then I set it oscillating, and you can see that it goes at a pretty good clip. It's got a small period or a high frequency. Now if I take this mass off, and using the same spring, I replace it with a large mass, and I add that on. The first thing, of course, you know is that the equilibrium position is a lot lower because the large mass has a larger weight. And now I set this oscillating, and you can see that it's oscillating with a far lower frequency, a far longer period. So clearly the mass affects the period of the spring mass system. Now, that's showing you the oscillations for this red spring. If I take an equal mass, and I add it now to the green spring. Now you can see here that the green spring has got a higher spring constant because although they all had the same length initially, now the green spring has got a shorter length than the red, and that tells you that since they've both got the same weight on the end, you have a higher spring constant for the green spring. If I set both of these oscillating, you can see that the green spring has a far higher frequency or a far lower period for the motion of its mass, and so clearly the period of oscillation is related to the spring constant as well. Now, this type of motion is what we call simple harmonic motion. And in order to understand exactly how the spring constant and the mass are related to the period of the motion, we need to do a little bit of maths and apply Newton's second law to this system. And that's what we'll be doing in the next video.